Good afternoon, everyone. I think we better start. As you know, we have limited time, and we want to finish so you guys can get back to the studio or the classes that you have. Today's speaker, Lawrence Nield, perhaps need no introduction. However, since he's not speaking about his work, it's appropriate to summarize various facets of his work and viewpoints that might inform today's talk. Lawrence has a number of interests: the design of architecture in cities, particularly buildings and public spaces, master planning and urban design of cities and campuses. He has been involved in the architecture and planning of 4 Olympic Games. Lawrence's other passion is teaching and writing. He has had a long interest in design teaching and writing on public architecture and cities, and has been a professor at Newcastle since 2011. In addition to being actively engaged at the university, he runs Studio Nield. He was also the founding director of Blywaller Nield, one of the most successful practices in Australia. Lawrence's other contributions include being the Northern Territory's government architect and the chair of New South Wales Heritage Council. He's a life fellow of Australian Institute of Architects, but his most notable accolade, and I think some of you were present on his gold medal speech when he won the award in 2012 of the Australian Institute of Architects. Lawrence's talk today is on the work of Swedish architect Sigurd Levant, who started his practice in architecture in 1911 and worked in association with Gunnar Espen, and some of you would be familiar with his work if you have been doing history and theory, on a number of significant buildings. Since Lawrence's talk is going to talk about Levant's work in detail, I would now like to invite Lawrence to share his insight and appreciation of his work. Please all welcome Lawrence.
Nina, thanks very much for that introduction. You've got to be careful on what spin you put on speakers, and so hopefully there's not too much spin. I'm going to talk round the great Swedish architect who died in 1964 called Sigurd Leverantz. But I'll be also talking about melancholy and death, and because the great buildings that Leverantz was involved with include cemeteries and churches. But I want to also use that as a parable of our profession as it stands now, about the melancholy and almost death of our profession in the way in its present trajectory. And I'll talk about that. But let me just firstly introduce Leverantz and the great Woodland Cemetery in Stockholm, in the south part of Stockholm, which he won the competition with Gunnar Asplund in 1919. But everything you see was built after 1924. It's a most amazing way that they won the competition, and the key part of the competition was this cross and the Chapel of the Holy Cross. And let me say, since I'll be going through a lot of religious buildings and cemeteries, Leverantz professed no religious faith, as Le Corbusier, with his great chapel at Ronchamp, also said when the father asked him to do it, how can I do it when I'm not a Christian? And he said, well, let's see. And in a sense, there was a lot more. You could say there was more objective. They were acting as a professional professional architect following their client's requirements. So Leverantz and Asplund won the Woodland Cemetery in 1919 and 1934. Now, this also is a very memorable and important building in my career. When I went to Sydney University in 1957, which was an absolutely second-rate school of architecture, even though JW went there too. But an architect in the very first week that we were there, called Arthur Baldwinson, gave a lecture on the Woodland Cemetery. And I was really impressed by that. There was almost no other architecture in the course for that year at all, except this one lecture on the Woodland Cemetery. And he ascribed it all to Gunnar Asplund. And this is not the case. I think more and more research has shown that it was Leverenz who was the main hand in the design and the main simplifier of the design. So this is a very significant piece, and my wife and I, in March, went back there in the snow, and I went there probably in 1964 or 5, again, when I first went to Sweden, and I was just as impressed as the second time round. I didn't see it in the snow. This time we saw it in the snow. One of the key parts which we'll see is the Grove of Remembrance with these torches around it that leads off to one great axis which ends in Leverenz's Chapel of the Resurrection. And the other axis leads to, this is called the Way of the the Way of the Cross, with the Grove of Remembrance, with these beautiful rough stairs. You can see, if I find my pointer, you can see you can see going up here, and then that leads to an axis down to an informal axis to the chapel of the Resurrection, which is Leverenz's great building. But he also designed the building we'll see at the end of here. But here is the cross that was central. And this is called either the Way of the Cross or the Urns, because in those walls are what are technically called in cemeteries columbaria, where you put the ashes. And comes up to the Chapel of the Holy Cross with an impluvium, with a Roman courtyard that goes into it. And you see that at the end as you walk up this way, and it's where the actual cremating and whatever the celebration is not the right word, the actual service occurs. This is all, by the way, a public building that was put into a competition, as they do in most of the public buildings, by the Stockholm County Council. This was finished in 1934. And is always ascribed to Asplund, but they both designed it, and then Leverenz fell out with the authorities and withdrew from the commission. There again, you see the Grove of Remembrance. Now, this is, as they say, this is one of the most spectacular landscapes. There are the dark Nordic woods on one side, the open grasslands, the mounds that remind you of death, which we'll talk about in Luce's famous inscription, but it is now on the World Heritage List. But it's said that whenever you go there, apart from, of course, when you go there for funerals, all you see is architects and planners and landscape architects. We went there in the snow and didn't see anyone else that much at all, but it's still very moving. There's the Chapel of the Holy Cross, with this impluvium that lives with a sculpture in the centre and the and if we go through and keep walking round past that, we come to Gunnar Asplund's little woodland chapel, which is also quite an extraordinary building. But this also shows the change that was going on in the 1920s. This style was called the National Romantic style, and Gunnar Asplund, and as we'll see, turned round from the National Romantic style very dramatically in 1930 with the Great Exhibition in Sweden, where the sort of white architecture of the modern movement in a most serious way was brought forward. But this is nevertheless Asplund's beautiful little chapel here, where we come to these crafted doors and through the doors into this space with the altar. All this quite open every day, and then going off to areas wall burial and so on beside that. And you can choose which chapel you want in this extraordinary place. Just to remind you, and this is irrelevant to the particular theme of melancholy and death today, this is Asplund's great library in Stockholm. And let's be quite clear that these buildings, like this one finished in 1934, because they're so considered a design, are still operating as wonderful buildings today, as is the library, which is completely original inside in all its details and so on. So we'll come and see that even more in Leverenz's buildings. So through this great Nordic forest, we have the light, the mounds, the lawn, and they're also full of symbolism. There's the seven gardens, the way of the cross, the reflecting water outside the thing, then the grove of remembrance. And then one gets into this dark Nordic forest full of graves. And this is where we need to start thinking about architecture and introduce the famous quote of Adolf Loos. When we do come across a mound in a wood, and surely this could be no other than this wood, 6 feet long and 3 feet wide, raised to a pyramidal form by means of a spade, we become serious and something in us says, someone lies buried here. This is architecture. So, of course, when dealing with death, and why did he say that? He's just saying that architecture is only involved with death and the buildings of death. Well, what he was trying to say, and this, of course, is relevant to all the buildings we're looking at today, but I want to expand this a bit further. He went on to say, only a very small, and this is Adolf Loos in Vienna, this is not a quote from Leverenz, only a very small part of architecture belongs to art, the tomb and the monument. The rest, every building that serves an end, and that's a much nicer word than a function, or that serves an end, should be excluded from the realm of art. So he's saying art can only be used in the tomb and the monument. In a sense, both buildings are involved with death. But let's just think about that. Because I think we need to think about it in two ways. Firstly, we're dealing with people that were at the very centre of the modern movement. 1922, they started building this stadium at the same time as the people we know perhaps more famously, like Corbusier and Gropius, were even later than that when we think of the Villa Savoye and so on. They started this transition to thinking about the modern movement. And they thought about the modern movement not as a style. I think it's very important, and this is why I'm saying this is a parable of what's happening to architecture today, that architecture and the modern movement were about dragging architecture away from architecture of the elite. They were dragging architecture away from dealing with churches and palazzos and the houses of the rich, and saying that public housing, social housing, aeroplane hangars, railway stations, hospitals were really the task of architecture, not just dealing with the diseases, if we could transfer it to the medicine of the rich. So I want to emphasise that the modern movement was a revolutionary movement, changing what architecture was about. And why I'm saying that this is a parable of where modern architecture is going is that we are going in many ways back to what architecture was. That is, a form of design for the rich and famous, and not a task of dealing with the great needs of public architecture and public space and so on. And the modern movement, initially, it's lost its way in this way, was about It was a movement of which, particularly in Sweden and in Germany, the serious practitioners saw it as a move away from what was considered architecture. And I just want to say in this parable of melancholy and death that we're moving back into what architecture was before the modern movement. Architecture designing houses for the rich. They are concentrating on, I can say this openly because I have never designed a house and I've only designed public buildings, so I can be very, very unfair to all the architects that do beautiful houses for the rich. We're designing for houses of the rich and we're designing for all sorts of the elite in the community, while, you know, more and more schools and hospitals and social housing is becoming less and less the task of architects. May not always be the architect's fault, but it is a problem. And the other problem is that architects are no longer practices. They're developing into companies, as engineers are. They're companies and they're just there to make money for their shareholders, usually the various principals in the practice. And therefore, they can't really be objective and fair because they've got to keep on earning a crust and keeping people employed. So, and engineers are even worse. An engineer will never do anything for you beyond the very minimal of tasks. Look, this is a majority of engineers, not the very good engineers, because they just work as a company. And architects are just becoming a company, even if they're not labelled a body corporate or a thing. And this means that they need to have the award system so all the people can see their work and then give them work. That's their way of advertising. And they develop a whole company structure rather than a practice. Now, how did Leverance do exactly what he wanted? He was lucky. He just chose absolutely who and what he wanted to work with and what competitions he went in. How did he do this? Well, from 1938 to for 16 years to the end of the Second World War, which of course Sweden was neutral and he wasn't involved. He ran a window company, and he made his money from building windows, and it'll be very interesting when we see some of his approach to windows. And because of this successful window company, he could take and leave the contracts he want. But with our architectural companies today, they can't take or leave the contracts they want. Of course, there are the good architects who can take and leave the architects, and they work as a practice and not as a company. But the vast amounts of big architectural offices act as a company and can't reject a lot of work. So that's the first thing I wanted to say about architecture and how important these architects of the 1920s were. The second point is, you know, what does Luce mean by architect? Well, my definition of architecture, which many of you here have heard before, is that architecture is about the framing of lives and materials in response to situation and circumstance. And by the way, circumstance is a word I found out subsequently when I thought of this that Leverance uses a lot. But architecture, that's a general thing about architecture, but it's always a good thing to refine where we can think of materials as having lives. Like, not just do they grow and creep, but they reflect their craftsmanship, they reflect the richness of the materials, they reflect the fire that they were made in and so on. So materials, and of course we have to organise it about the lives of the people that live there. That's a very general definition. But then we can go on one step further and say architecture's about inside, outside. So you have some architects, particularly the pastry cooks of today, that only design on the outside of the building. And I would argue quite strongly that there are a very large number of pastry cooks in Melbourne that just work on the outside of the building and not the inside. Then there are other architects that work from the inside of the building, expressing the structure with apartments, just reading the park. And so you can also work from the inside to make architecture, or you can bring the inside and the outside together. And that sounds simple, but it's difficult to do. It's much easier to be just a pastry cook on the outside. We want to bring the inside and the outside together. And that even applies to elements like walls and roofs. We can either make the roof reflect the inside and the outside, or we can make the walls reflect the inside and the outside, so the same material is seen on the inside. So to think about leverance, I think a helpful way is to think about that idea of the simple notion of architecture being the inside and the outside. But back to the Woodland Cemetery. At right angles to the line that comes, and it's like many great pieces of order, is an orthogonal grid with some more curvilinear roads joining it up. And at right angles to the line of force from the Grove of Remembrance is this path that comes across, where you can see Leverance's Chapel of the Resurrection straight ahead of you. And just look at the scale and look at the Nordic forest and contrast with that from what you... And you keep walking up and you see the Chapel of the Resurrection, which was finished 3 years after the opening of the cemetery, which has two entrances to... But this is the way you enter, and you come up and walk through this main portico, which is enormously subtle when you're there, because the portico is not actually attached parallel with the main wall behind. It is slightly rotated, so it exactly closes this axis. And there is a slight rotation if it was a church, you would call the nave behind. So you go in through this entrance, and if you look back before you go in, there is this great access through the forest, and come in and see the altar, or as I said, this is a public building, so it can be used for many religions, even as you can see there for Jewish burials and so on. So, but it has, and this was, in a sense, Leverance as moving away from the national romantic ideas, and almost saying that he doesn't like the way that Asplund's made that little Woodlands chapel. Let me then also say, talking about the death of architecture, the other great thing about Leverance was he never wrote one single word about architecture. He allowed the buildings to do the speaking. made that, true, that absolute quote that Matisse said, that all artists should have their tongue cut out so they don't go around putting spin on their buildings or on their art. So Leverance never wrote anything about architecture. He just let the buildings speak, and could the buildings speak. So he firstly moved into what's called the Nordic Gothic, this very plain and absolutely beautiful, even better than Schinkel, who was 80 years earlier, and the great Berlin architect. He could control the classical elements better than Schinkel in Berlin. So just to look at that. But then came his falling out with the cemetery. In the meantime, he won the Malmo Cemetery, which was only partly built. In the 1940s, he did two little chapels, some nooks, very Scandinavian name, in Malmo, and began to, after this, moving away from the Romantic through the Nordic Gothic, began to think about architecture as part of the modern movement. And we see here, he is a sort of architect, I believe, but he never wrote anything, who would be able to pick up a nail and say, how do I use this nail? What's the best way to use the nail? What is the best way to use this screw? And he absolutely thought everything through. And when he won two competitions, one in Stockholm and one at about 100 kilometres at Klippan outside Stockholm, but in another little church in a forest in the south of Stockholm, he began to think about the brick, which he hadn't thought about before. And he set himself a rule of building St Mark's Church, same St Mark as there is in Venice, the Mark in Borgenhaven in the south of Stockholm. He said, I'm going to build a building with no special bricks and no cutting of bricks. So he said, every brick will be used in its full extent. And naturally that meant he had to increase the size of the joints and the perpends and so on, which he did. But then he made special, put ground up and put flint into the actual mortar. So he began to think about every single material in that way. And I just, again, go back to another quote that I find very useful and again applies to the pastry cooks who do things on the outside of buildings. Today, the difference between a good and a poor architect, architect's been reported there twice now, architect is that the poor architect succumbs to every temptation and the good one resists it. That's what Ludwig Wittgenstein, the philosopher, said. And nobody would more and could resist temptation than Leverance in this sort of castle-like little church that sits in a forest, closely enough to the railway station, where you see this, and it rather reminds you, as Colin St. John Wilson says, of the great church in the Trastevere by Borromini called St. Mary's of the Seven Sadnesses, Sette Dolore. It has this extraordinary roughness as though it's been there forever. And then one goes from that into through the door and the bell here, looking up at the bell, and into the church itself. And everything is made in this language that he developed. The roof, the vaults of the roof are made out of brick, all the walls, even up to the top of the altar is made out of this brick, and large parts of the floor are made out of this brick. And going back to that little analogy I said, you know, this is a building that is very much about inside and outside, bringing the inside and outside together. And extraordinary use of low light, light directed it in, and yet a very welcoming place. You can open up the end of the hall here into a much larger space and then into a dining space, and which we see on the right, where this is how he captured the water from the this beautiful sculptured item from, you see, from the canopy above, and then the offices for the clergy and other people on the other side there who live there, beautiful bronze, and you can see even there and in the canopies the brick vaults repeated and reflect the inside work, and that every single downpipe you see is thought through. I found even, and I should have shown a photograph of this, Even in the men's, in the urinals in the men's lavatory, he's arranged all the plumbing in a quite unique way. This was an old man's building. He was nearly 80 when he did this, and as I said, he did it because it was a thing he wanted to do, and the copper roofs. Sitting there as though it has been there forever, and yet it was built in 1960. So just the inside of that. This is looking up under the canopies, which are again beautifully designed. And I apologise for my poor photographs, but and the wonderful brick vaulting and how he used those full bricks and everything he touched, the lighting, he just sat there and said, how should this lighting work? How should it go? And this was embraced, I think, wrongly by the brutalists in the 1960s and 70s. This doesn't feel at all brutal when you're in there. It doesn't have huge bits of graying concrete. It has these almost the only other people that I know of that have used brickwork like this are the Persians, where they also had in some of their used these very large joints and no cutting of bricks. So the windows themselves are extraordinary. Here is a man who ran a window company who would be, you know, telling architects how to flash all their windows. He worked out a way of just putting, before we had all the various plastic sealants that we have now, how to put glass exactly on the outside of this brick wall. He thought, I don't want to see a frame here, I just want glass to close that space. Here's the very simple plan with the main road and how you walk into the side and then this community space. And it is, you know, really, really very, very simple. But the key thing is that it frames people's lives, not just the building. Here is the main church, but that then opens up into here. Then there's a library here, and you go up to a further library, and there's some places where you can have. And this is all places where you can eat. And people, when we were there, you know, it was like a community, a real community building. And then the clergy living here, and you just walk through a forest path into there, then into the church or into this space in here, depending on whether you want to go to the service. My wife and I were tried to convince to join the service by the minister, but. So, going back to the quote by Lewis, you know, architecture in its form as an art should be restricted to death, to monuments. And the way we look at Leverance, we see that he brings, I think you'll see it even more in the St. Peter's at Clipham. He looked at building construction and he looked at it and he looked at it and he studied it. Like the thing I made up about if he had a nail, sure. But he studied the structure, he studied the bricks until it became symbolic, till it developed a metaphor from the construction, from the building construction or from the space, not I've got a great idea and I'm going to impose this onto the building. He thought, in a sense, through the materials all the time and dealt with the sacred. Now, these are the similar windows, and this started immediately after the Marcus Kirche, the St. Mark's Church. Here is his windows clipped on the outside. This is St. Peter's at Clipham. But he took this one step further than he did. And he was already 80 when he started
this building. These again almost look like plaques or places to put, but these are windows that bring light into the space where he wants it. But the tour de force in this is this almost dull building around the outside, and then almost opening up and, as several people have said, finding the true cross. By the way, this is all done by someone who doesn't believe in Christianity. So there's your approach by a lake, and come in as you do, in a quite modestly sliding into the building. And the same, exactly the same brickwork, the same brick vaults, his lights that he saw through that you had in St Mark's. And then you come in to the centre here, and this is unlike, which was an axial one, an axial church at St Mark's, at St Peter's. It's a square. There was someone who was interested in a different liturgy, a much more primitive liturgy. So this person, as I said, he never thought and talked about anything except through his buildings. But the fellow who talked to him about the liturgy said they wanted to try and create a very simple space, as in the first Christian spaces in the catacombs in Rome, just gathered round a very simple altar. But in getting this square form that enabled the much more in the round, he had a problem of having quite extensive spans, over 20 metres. And again, in his thinking about everything he touched, he thought of ways to hold that up, and bought this building form that doesn't pretend to be a cross, but can be read metaphorically as a cross in the very centre of the church. And don't forget, it was Leverance who put that cross on the hill in the Woodland Cemetery. Here he doesn't labour the point, he doesn't make it thing. Here is that he had to hold up his 20 metre span, or in fact I think it's 18 metre span, and he put this one cross, then these other steel, this is all in steel, and then holding up the brick vaults above that, the bricks go into a steel rolled hollow section. So he put in the centre of this primitive church, as several people have said, you know, the finding of the true cross. And this was really quite an astonishing building, because, and what I find is that he worked, you know, he's been in that whole period I said where modern architecture was a revolution, it should have been a revolution, and he kept it thinking through an architecture as practice and not as company. Again, didn't matter what he looked at, whether it was the paving, which is, as I said, brick and tiles, or the entrance canopies on the other side of this. This is another device he had for letting in light that comes into there is very little light in St Peter's, but what is so subtle and so conceited. This light comes into these brick boxes and then is reflected back, or reflects is not the right word, seeps back into the darkened centre. And as you can again, you see the man who owned a window factory not even saying, oh, I'm going to use my type B windows in this. I'm going to think through windows from where windows began. We just want them to let light in and to be able to keep the integrity of the brickwork. There's again, this is from trying to get a better photograph of the actual cross, but that's how it works. There in the centre with, you know, the fact that it's holding up these massive brick vaults, you can really feel the strength
and the problems of a cross. Seeing it again, and there are the windows. So, no one, Ruskin said, and Ruskin was a strange fellow, but nevertheless he knew a lot about architecture and drawing. His guide to drawing is something that all architects should read. Ruskin said, no one can be an architect who's not a metaphysician. And I think with Leverenz, he was a real metaphysician. He could think through materials into these great solutions like the cross, like the windows, like the bricks with no specials and no cuts. And he brought together, probably shouldn't be saying this, but as an old man, he brought together this idea of, absolute the ability to have the appearance and the construction as one. The idea that you had a truth that came out of that you could feel about building it and yet was still finished. And it reminds me very much of this huge, this is the Rondini, the Pietà Rondini by Michelangelo, who also was 80 and died when he did this work, like Leverenz was on the Klippan, where he... you can almost feel the blows of the chisel and hammer on this. You can, yet it has that extraordinary intensity. You can feel it growing out of the Carrara marble at the bottom, and the way that Leverenz brought together the truth of both appearance and making, I think one of the most important and the great... I've not been able to achieve it in my work, some small segments of it, but getting the feeling of making and the final appearance in one thing and getting inside and out. Architecture becomes great when it can deal with both the outside and the inside and not just stress one thing or the other. And like Michelangelo, who I think Leverenz is, in a sense, in modern times, an equivalent of, you can feel every blow of the hammer and yet you can get this extraordinary symbolism and emotion in this building. So just to finish, Leverenz is someone I think you need to really... look at, and he was a deep mover in architecture. He did only 5 or 6 buildings, but I recommend to you that you go and visit every one of those buildings. Thank you.